want to just share with you that I'd like to dedicate this teaching to my father, who's in the hospital, and he is recovering from diverticulitis. Some of you are familiar with that. My grandfather had it. My dad has it, and I have it. And we know that sometimes curses can be handed down physically. You can see this in your own life sometimes. Not that we want to fall into it or we're going to be trapped in that curse, but we have to, of course, be in reality of the facts, the diagnosis, and pray for the curse to be broken and for healing. Amen. Strong believer in that. I've had some strange symptoms and things happening to me personally, and I'm reminded of Paul, the thorn in the flesh. You know, there's so much mystery about that. I personally believe he was literally afflicted physically, because we can spiritualize all we want. How many know that when there's a pain in your body, that's not a spirit? That's your body telling you there's something wrong. Amen. I mean, if you didn't have pain, you would just fall over and die because your body's telling you, hey, something's wrong, go to the hospital. So with that said, you know, my father is a great patriarch, just an awesome man of God to me, taught me many values. He taught me integrity and character, be a man of your word, work for everything that you have, and then no one can take it. Amen. And we live in a generation of entitlements right now. And let me assure all of you at all ages, we are not entitled to anything. Amen? So if life doesn't go your way, rejoice. I say again, rejoice. Amen. You know, we live in a world of pain and suffering, you know? And I want to remind all of you, when you're going through what you're going through, maybe you've just recovered from something, maybe you're going through something right now. Let me remind you, a lot of times I'm going through the same thing you're going through. Probably even at a greater impact, because the enemy wants to shut down the message. He wants to shut down communication. He loves Babylon because it's Babel. That's what our culture is, a bunch of Babylonians, a bunch of babbling. That's why when I get online or whatever I'm doing on my phone, getting on the World Wide Web or whatever it is, I don't find it interesting to hear people's opinions on a news story. I'm not into blogs and people's opinions about, you know, campaigns or presidents or parties or the church. Or how many know what a waste of time that is? God doesn't care what you think. He doesn't care about your opinion. And why put that in your spirit? It's like on YouTube, if you listen to a song, it'll be a beautiful song. And if you scroll down to the comments, there's horrendous things being said about a religious song. Just don't scroll down. Get it? Don't go down. Go up. And I've witnessed a lot of incredible things, you know, visiting my father, you know, just the pain and suffering that he's going through right now, being a heart transplant recipient, you know, empathy just stirs up inside of me to just be there for him and hold his hand, you know, and tears are coming down his face. And so we live in a culture where we don't even recognize why that's here, pain and suffering. Why would a God allow this to happen and that to happen? That's what we hear. Let me tell you why. Because of sin. Because you don't know the God I know. He is holy. And because of what Adam and Eve did in the garden, it's handed down from generation to generation to generation through the seed of Adam. Thank God for the second Adam, Yeshua HaMashiach. Amen? You have to understand this. We live in a society that doesn't even believe in God, let alone a holy God. We're not going to get anywhere with these people. They've chosen their fate. We not only believe in God, we believe he's a holy God, and we believe that he speaks to us. Let me assure you, there's so many false prophets running around. You need to turn to this. This is where I get a word. Don't be drawn to fancy teachings, deep mysteries of revelation knowledge, and these preachers. Stay away from that stuff. This is what we need. I've been spending almost 50 years trying to get right. It's still not right. We got to make everything relevant. We got to be united. We got to have unity. You might be going through something, but at least we're all on the same page. Amen? That's why I want to share with you this message. I want to make it relevant. I want to tell you the truth. And I'm not going to tell you it's easy or it's going to get easier. No, it gets harder and harder and harder. I'm telling you this. I've been in this for 20 years. And if you think it's getting easier, you're following the wrong thing. Because I've realized this, you know. It's like the Holy Spirit telling me, how badly do you want to be the bride? How badly do you want to be a son and daughter of God? How much are you willing to give up to do this? How much are you willing to suffer to attain that? And it's personal. We live in a culture and an arena of competition with each other when we shouldn't be competing against each other. We compete against ourselves. You compete against yourself every day and do what you have to do to get better. Do whatever it takes. The Lord's been ministering to me. He's like, you know, your words have held you back. He didn't mention any of you. He didn't talk about the church. He didn't talk about the government. He talked to me as a father would speak to a son. And he's like, son, I want to do so much for you, but your own words have held you back. Can I go to my wife for that? No. Can I blame 7 kids? People say, I don't know how you do it. I don't know either. And this ain't about shame or guilt or beating yourself up. I want you to hear me out. I'm at a place in my walk where the Lord is taking me to task. He's taking me behind the woodshed. He's not going to cut any slack. If it ain't right, it ain't right. He's not going to give me a grade on a curve. Your grade is your grade. And what did Paul say? I run a race, a shadow box. Amen? He was competing against himself. And that's the way it's meant to be. We're supposed to be one-on-one with the Lord. He said he will gather us one by one. And so, in all you're getting, get understanding. So as you look at this particular Torah portion, we're going to go right from the beginning of it, and I'm going to share with you exactly what is going on today. Exactly what is going on, what to expect. Amen? I'm going to share exactly what is going on. Because we need to have a strategy. We need to have a plan of action. I'm not just going to wake up and try to figure it out. I got a plan. He's got a plan. Restoration will always bring resistance. You're going to love this. Oh, this is so good. You can build on this. We want resistance to go away. Go away. Why am I having difficulties? Why is this happening? Why is that happening? Because you're doing the right thing. Right out of the gate, look at Exodus chapter 6, verses 2 through 5. This particular Torah portion is going in every synagogue all over the world. Let's read it. And God spake unto Moses and said unto him, I am the Lord. And I appeared unto Abraham, unto Isaac, and unto Jacob by the name of God Almighty. But by my name Jehovah was I not known to them. And I have also established my covenant with them to give them the land of Canaan, the land of their pilgrimage, wherein they were strangers. And I have also heard the groaning of the children of Israel, whom the Egyptians keep in bondage, and I have remembered my covenant. See, everything is intensifying right now in the earth because something's about ready to give birth. The birth pain. Remember the birth pangs. He's reminding Moses, of his covenant. Amen? He's actually saying, listen, I revealed myself to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in this manner, but now I'm going to take you a step further. I'm going to reveal even more to you. Because that's what the Father does. Moses got to see the backside, didn't he? The word restoration means the action of returning something to a former owner, place, or condition. It's a noun. Person, place, or thing. Let me read that to you again. Restoration means the action of returning something to a former owner, place, or condition. So what you're seeing is cyclical in nature, meaning this, you need to know the original thing in order to produce the original thing. So if all you know is counterfeit, that's what we reproduce in the church. Imitation is the highest form of flattery. So we have to get back to the original model. The enemy doesn't want you to have the recipe for Israel. Because Israel was the original witness in the earth that God created to be a witness to who? The nations. And so I'm here to help you on the journey. I'm here to verify and to actually, I'm here to help to actually go along with what's going on inside of you. Because we're all there. There's something going on inside of me. I want to do this and I want to do that. I'm drawn to this. I'm drawn to that. Amen. I'm here to bear witness with what's already inside of you. Because you need to understand in all you're getting, get understanding. So the action of returning something to a former owner, place, or condition. If I go to your refrigerator and I open it up and I take a Coke out, and I say, listen, I'm going to restore this back to you. And I drink it down. And you open up the refrigerator a few days later, and you see a Sam's soda. How many of you know you're not going to be all excited about that? You're going to be like, wait a minute. You took a Coca-Cola, and now you're trying to pull apostasy on me, you heretic. And you gave me a Sam's soda. We've all been there. Come on. Czech soda? Are you kidding me? It's apostasy. But this is what the church is doing, and they don't even know it. It's full of apostasy, and they don't even realize it. They're so far off the mark. So many crazy teachings out there, it boggles my mind. It's like, oh, the Jews are natural Israel, and the church is spiritual Israel. Man, that's called split personalities. That's called Sybil. No, come on, everybody. This makes sense. All my children are treated the same. Same fairness, same regulations, rules, or whatever. It goes for everyone, amen? You don't have rules for these kids, and then rules for these kids. This is the problem we're having. So you, oh, thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Holy Spirit. The reason why we're all here is because our Father's revealing himself to us. We belong to him. We can't be deluded. We can't be ignorant. He wants to pour it out on us. Say, here, these are what my children do. This is what I'm asking of you. Amen. If I ask my children, hey, let's take the trash out, I didn't ask you to do the dishes. This is why the most disturbing probably reference of scripture is when Yeshua says, depart from me, I never knew you. But wait a minute, I did all these things in your name. I never knew you. You did what you wanted to do. You didn't do what I asked you to do. This is what it's about, everybody. It's coming. And if it ain't painful and you ain't weeping, you're not in the process. What does it take to get your attention? This is the real deal, everybody. Think about it. Let's look at the Abrahamic covenant. It consists of a promise made by God to Abraham and his descendants that they would get the land. Amen? Because he said right there in Exodus chapter 6, verses 2 through 5, I'm just going to refresh your memory, I have also established my covenant with them to give them the land of Canaan. Now listen to me. The land of Israel is a big deal in this church. It is a big deal. Matter of fact, we just jacked it up a few notches this last year. On my last visit, I had revelation knowledge from my Father in heaven to put inside of me a love for the land. So much that I care about the land. So much that he was telling me, scope it out, get your perspective, know where you're at, know what's going on around the land. And you look at the references, simple references. Genesis chapter 12, verse 1 and verse 7, and Genesis chapter 13, verse 15. I'm going to point something out to you that was very interesting on this trip. If we could just, we're just going to go to Genesis chapter 13. I'm going to point something out in the spirit to you that you're going to see in the natural. Let's look at Genesis 13, verse 14. Abram moves to Hebron. And the Lord said unto Abram, after that Lot was separated from him, lift up now thine eyes and look from the place where thou art northward and southward and eastward and westward. Amen? Amen. For all the land which thou seest, to thee will I give it, and to thy seed forever. In Galatians it says that if you're in Christ, you're Abraham's seed. Raise your hand if you're in Christ. You are the seed of Abraham, bar none. Bam! The seed. And I will make thy seed as the dust of the earth, so that it, if a man cannot or can number the dust of the earth, then shall thy seed also be numbered. Arise, walk through the land in the length of it and in the breadth of it, for I will give it unto thee. Then Abram removed his tent and came and dwelt in the plain of Mamre, which is in Hebron, and built there an altar unto the Lord. Do you see where Hebron's mentioned? Interesting. Now, before I read this, we have another person called the nephew of Abraham, Lot. We're going in the right direction. Some of our family members are going in the wrong direction. It says that Lot pitched his tent towards Sodom. Next thing you know, he's the mayor of Sodom. He's at the gate. The land of Israel will always bring you closer to the Lord. The land of Israel will always bring you closer to the Lord. You ever play that game, hot and cold? Try to find the item? You want to be hot, hot, hot. Hot, hot, hot. I find it interesting that Islam would lay claim to these biblical cities that they have no history of. Hebron is a good example. Why should Islam have a stronghold in Hebron? Have you ever thought about it? Why? Why the Dome of the Rock in Jerusalem? Why? Why Bethlehem? Why is Bethlehem controlled by Islam? Why is Jericho? I thought the walls came down. Are you rebuilding them? Have you ever wondered? See, the spiritual warfare. The devil wants to undo everything that Yahweh has declared and achieved. We got to fight to get it back. It ain't going to be given to you. It's not going to be given to you. Hebron. Hebron. I couldn't even go see the tomb of Isaac and Rebekah, because it was under Palestinian control. I got to go through a whole set of steps to even attempt it. And the first time that you walk into this shrine, to the right, they got a tomb for Ishmael. He isn't even there. I'm just pointing this out. If I was a tour guide, I would point it out. That's going to be my next job, a tour guide. Tour guide. Why am I sharing all this? Because you need to know, and the time is drawing near. I don't know how much time we have, but we have to respond to the revelation. We have to respond to the education that the Father wants to give us. Because I had the most incredible things happen to me this last year in regard to the land. And I don't have all the pieces. Genesis chapter 15, verses 13 and 14, in regard to Egypt, let's read it together. And he said unto Abram, know of a surety that thy seed shall be a stranger in a land that is not theirs, and shall serve them, and they shall afflict them 400 years, and also that nation whom they shall serve will I judge, and afterward shall they come out with great substance. A stranger in a land that is not theirs, Egypt, world empire. He said, for 400 years, this is where they will be, and they will not leave empty-handed. Come on, somebody. You're all wondering, well, how can we leave this place without any substance? I don't have time to get into it, but if you read the prophets, it says that the Gentiles will come and aid you. It even says this, I will send the Gentiles to carry your children back. I could use that. I got 7 kids. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Listen, if we're not obedient, we'll get no substance because you're going the wrong way. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Some of you are wondering why you have lack. It's because you're going the wrong way. You need to fix it. You need to correct it. He's our provision. You might not like your job where you're at, but you just don't quit your job for nothing. God's got to have a plan for you. Don't get an attitude. Humble yourself. He'll provide for you. I've learned this, folks. You might not like where you're at. You might not like your circumstances. But if you don't know, you don't go. So he's even telling them through Abraham and the descendants what's going to happen. So let's think about this, because this is important. Because if I could give you anything, I want you to be in the state of restoration. If I pulled you up here, put you on a seat, prove to me that you're in the restoration process. Is there enough evidence to convict you? How have you restored the kingdom of God? We're all going to be on the stand. Think about it. Restoration will always give you a purpose. Some of you are wondering, I haven't heard from God. I don't know what I'm doing. Well, you better figure it out. You better have a purpose. Look at Exodus 5:1. Let's read it. And afterward, Moses and Aaron went in and told Pharaoh, thus saith the Lord God of Israel, let my people go, that they may hold a feast unto me in the wilderness. One of the purposes found in the Hebrew roots of the Christian faith is keeping the Sabbath along with the feasts. Leviticus 23. Every Friday night, I have a purpose. Amen? And the feasts give you a purpose. So let me ask you a question. If that's no longer a purpose, the Sabbath and the feasts, what has happened to you personally? Could be a heart issue. Could be the 17 works of the flesh. We try to read the Torah portion every Friday night. I went up to go visit my father, and I wasn't in a hurry to get out of there either. So I went up and visited him and prayed with him and held his hand and anointed him and, you know, called him a great man of God and patriarch, spoke into his life. And it got late. So then I, talking to my wife at home, and I'm asking them about, you know, reading the Torah portion and everything. Things got kind of, you know, chaotic and things going on. And I wasn't there to really enforce it. But my wife was telling me, Hadassah wanted me to tell you that she read the Torah portion. Now, we're all going to be in a test. Amen. You know, right now I feel very weak. I don't feel up to par. But when I'm weak, he is strong. When I'm weak, I can let other people step in because it's not about me. None of this is about me. I'm trying my best to tell you the truth and lead you to the truth giver. That's what I'm trying to do. Because you should never draw people to yourself. That's what false prophets do. So you have to have purpose. Restoration will always bring family members together. Amen? Exodus 4:27, let's read it. And the Lord said to Aaron, go into the wilderness to meet Moses. And he went and met him in the mouth of God and kissed him. Don't you love a family reunion? Well, how can you have one if you've isolated yourself from your family? You have to do your part. If it be possible, be at peace with all men. Amen? Does everybody understand that? If it be possible, sometimes it's not. But look at Aaron and Moses reunited. Does everybody see that? What about the father of Joseph, Jacob? Wasn't he reunited with Joseph in Egypt? Boy, there's a lot of stuff going on in Egypt, isn't there? A lot of stuff going on. Think about it. Look around. Look at some of your family members. Some of the family members were here, and then the other family members followed. Right? So Linda Carter was here first. She started working on Kathy, working her over. Subliminal messages, whatever she had to do. She's the secretary of Beit Tehila. Amen? It's just like the Kinney family. There's three generations in here already, like that. Never give up on your family. I told my brother I want him to come and sit with me on the front row with Jeremy, and just I'm going to start coming to church. I'm not going to let up. Amen? You're going to see my brother sit next to me one day. Amen. So it is a family affair. See, all of you represent your family. You're the first one to be born again, filled with the Spirit, and have the Torah. What do you expect? They're still trying to figure you out. Because some of you have been goofy all your life. And now you go into this, and they're like, well, here's another spell. Yeah. Yeah, mom did this and this, and now Hebrew roots. Woohoo! Got to get my Hebrew roots. Woohoo, mama! Well, listen, they said Jesus had demons, so what I'm sharing with you is really not that personal. Once again, restoration will always bring resistance. Look at this picture. You'll see two symbols there, power and truth. One person represents power. The other person represents truth. So looking at that picture, who do you think has the power? Pharaoh. Pharaoh has the power. But who has the truth? Who wins? Truth always wins. Remember that. Truth always comes out into the light. If not, in the next life, in this life, truth will always come up to the surface. And it's interesting in the times in that we're living that a lot of lies are being exposed. People are being called out. Truth is coming up to the surface. Amen? The word resistance. The word resistance means the refusal to accept or comply with something. The attempt to prevent something by action or argument. Take this into the presidential election was their resistance. Isn't there still resistance? Didn't somebody climb up a crane or something and put a flag up and it said, resist? An actor screaming at another person, screaming, you will not divide us. You will not divide us. You will not divide us. And he went to jail. Do you see the things happening in our culture that you never think you would see? I mean, mobs. So there's an injustice. So let's just give another injustice. There's been an injustice. Let's rob, kill, steal, destroy. Let's do vandalism and theft. Let's exchange evil for evil. And that's what we're seeing. I'm not interested in a protest. Amen? I'm just not interested in that. I believe in freedom of speech, but I got way too much to do to be in a mob. Guilty by association. Guilty by association. So once again, the word resistance means the refusal to accept or comply with something. President Trump is the president. Whether you want it or not. You could say you don't comply, but you better. And pray for him. Right? The attempt to prevent something by action or argument. See, what I'm getting to is the truth that's inside of you is the resistance is coming. But it's only if the truth is inside of you will you be resisted. You won't be resisted for lies. Not in the kingdom of God, you won't. It's only when you stand up for what is right. Here's a quote. People will always criticize what they do not understand. I ran into a pastor one time and I was talking with him. He says, oh, messianic. Oh, I did that. That wasn't good. I said, how do you define messianic then? If that isn't something that you liked or you had a bad experience with a messianic congregation, and I said, well, explain to me then what messianic is. There's no explanation. Of course you're disappointed because you don't even know what it is. Amen? I had a bad experience in a messianic. Really? Well, you define to me what messianic is then. Because obviously it's been defined wrong. So define to me what messianic is. See, I'm defining the Hebrew roots of the Christian faith. I'm redefining it. I'm redefining the Hebrew roots of the Christian faith. In case you haven't noticed, I'm redefining it to break away from that stereotype. Once again, people will always criticize what they do not understand. Don't take it personal. Don't. You shouldn't get all riled up. I'll show them. I got all these scripture bullets. It's not what you want. Because they've already got a wall up. They're not going to receive. Pull that plane up. Do not land it. The runway lights are off. Don't crash land. When you see somebody asking questions and they're interested, then you land that puppy. Otherwise, pull up, pull up. Resistance can come from ignorance. Exodus 5:2, let's read it together. And Pharaoh said, who is the Lord that I should obey his voice to let Israel go? I know not the Lord, neither will I let Israel go. Who's the Lord? I know not the Lord. So you go in Hebrew roots, and they're like, what's Hebrew roots? That's what they do to you. What's this thing? It's like manna, right? What's this? They don't know what Hebrew roots is. They've heard this, maybe got online or something, and they saw the bad stuff. People trying to define what it is when that's not what it is. One of the biggest stereotypes is, oh, works for salvation. Hebrew roots, that's what they're all about. Are you kidding me? That's a poor definition. Listen, if you don't define something, somebody else will for you. You better define it. So once again, resistance can come from ignorance. Here's a good one. Resistance can come from those that are spiteful. You wonder why people are doing things to you. And all this is happening because inside of you is truth. You should rejoice when they respond like that. When you're treated poorly and people call you out, they're ganging up on you, say, woohoo, yeah, baby. That's what I like. Look at Exodus 5, 17 and 18. Let's read it. But he, Pharaoh, said, ye are idle. You are idle. Therefore, ye say, let us go and do sacrifice to the Lord. Go therefore now and work, for there shall no straw be given you, yet shall ye deliver the tale of bricks. This is so relevant for today. I want you to think about this with me. Listen to this. Pharaoh thought that the children of Israel were idle because they wanted to sacrifice to the Lord, do spiritual exercises. Ooh. When the world looks at you and they see you reading your Bible, praying, worshiping, they're like, what a waste of time. But it's not. It's not a waste of time. I believe you're idle when you don't do spiritual exercises. You know, my father was a workaholic, and I believe my grandfather was, some of the stories I heard, and I became a workaholic, and I had to get delivered of being a workaholic. Because I just felt like, well, they would let me work all the hours I wanted, because why? The enemy will feed the curse. If I just make more money and I'm doing something, I'm providing for my family above me, I'm really doing, but guess what? I wasn't with my family. And the Lord took me behind the woodshed. He says, you have the curse of being a workaholic. I'm like, oh, I gotta do something about this, man. I had to do a breathing exercise, you know, because I'm already conditioned, man. I mean, I'm not kidding you. If they would let me work 80 hours, I would. I think I've worked like 60 to 70 hours many, many times at the box plant. Do the math, folks. 60, 70 hours. So then when the Lord began to tell me, you got to wean yourself off these hours and be with your family. Don't worry about the money. Worry about your family. Oh, that. When I worked 50 hours, I felt like I was ripping the company off. You should see me when I just worked 40 hours. I'm like, what is this, part-time? I'm working part-time now. But I got delivered of that. I'm not a workaholic anymore. I realized, amen, it's just like with ministry. When I come home, I don't want to talk ministry or church. I want to talk to my kids, my wife, and whatever, and I don't just go tell my wife everything. I only tell her things I need to tell her or things we need to pray about together, but I don't unload on my wife so I could vent because she's got, you know, seven other churches going on at the house. So I only tell her, you know, what I would want to tell her, but I don't purposely to just tell her everything that I'm doing. Some things are confidential. We all have to learn how to do that. Because I got to take my pastor hat off and put my husband and father hat on when I walk in the house. Because that's what the kids want. They don't want a pastor. They want a father. My wife wants a husband, not a pastor. It's funny because we have this interesting relationship. And I have to tell her, all right, I'm the pastor. I got the pastor hat on. Listen closely. I'm the pastor. Listen to this. And then I'll take the pastor hat off and say, listen, I'm putting my husband hat on. I'm talking to you as a husband, not as a pastor. I have to differentiate a lot of times. Because that's how people feel. Oh, don't lecture me. That's what I do for a living. I'm doing a lecture on resistance. Once again, let me say this to you. Pharaoh thought that the children of Israel were idle because they wanted to sacrifice to the Lord, which means spiritual exercises. Listen to me closely. If you don't like to pray, if you don't like to read your Bible, and you don't like to worship God, listen to me closely. There is something wrong inside of you. You have to find out what it is. And I'm not going to get, that's a whole nother teaching. I have to do a spiritual audit all the time. How come I'm not at prayer? Or how come I'm not praying? How come I'm not reading my Bible? How come I'm not worshiping? How come I'm in another place and I'm distracted and I'm not worshiping? I'm not reading my Bible or I'm not praying? I have to do a gut check and find out. And there's many, many reasons for this. You could give your affection out to all these things and there's nothing for the Lord. That's why always give your affection to the Lord in the morning. Give him your affection right out of the gate. Because if you say this, I'll do it tonight before I go to bed, you have wasted your affection throughout the day. And you've given it to everybody else and everything else, and God gets nothing. Start your day off with him. Tell him you love him. Do something. Get a ritual going. Do the hand washing. Pray. Read Proverbs. Amen. Give him your affection right out of the gate. Go for a prayer walk. Whatever you got to do. Because if you're telling me, oh, I do it at night, you're a liar. And you might do it. You might go through the motions, but those affections won't be there. Amen? Just as I went to go see my dad, you know, I just felt like, you know, dealing with some stubbornness and stuff inside of me. Because, you know, you ever heard of stiff neck? So I held my father's hand in the hospital bed, and I just got on my knees and just bowed my head and said, Father, I submit myself to you. It ain't about drawing attention. It ain't about, oh, look at him on his knees. It's about telling my flesh, you have no hold on me. I will humble myself before my God and show honor to my Father. Sometimes we have to do that. Did you notice people coming up on the stairs? That wasn't a show. Hey, look at her. Oh, look at her. She went up. She just wants attention. No, you're humbling yourself. You tell the flesh, I'm humbling my. And the enemy wants to try to tell you something else because he doesn't want to bow before the Lord. But every knee shall bow. Every tongue confess. So the word spite means what? Do we ever do that one yet? The word spite. A mean or evil feeling toward another, characterized by the inclination to hurt, humiliate, annoy, or frustrate. We didn't see that in this election. You know, I tell the story, I had a fan, the fan was on me, my roommate took it. I went back, took it from him, and I threw it on the ground and broke it. I said, nobody gets it. It was an outburst of anger, it was wrong. But I tell you the story because that's what the enemy wants to do. That's what people want to do to you. But you shouldn't want to do that to them. You do it out of spite. I believe President Obama did a lot of things out of spite to the next president that was coming in. I believe that. Why would he do this at the last minute? He really thought Hillary was going to win, folks. They all thought Hillary was going to. So he had a game plan. Oh, we're going to do this. We're going to have a big pate and, oh, all this stuff and drinks and food and big fat bomb. Next contestant. How could the polls be wrong? God puts in who he wants in office. A mean or evil feeling toward another, characterized by the inclination to hurt, humiliate, annoy, or frustrate, etc., out of spite. Remember this. Oh, thank you, Holy Spirit. If you're gunning for somebody, and you're really gunning for them, and you say, I'm taking this person out. I'm gonna blast them. It's coming to your house. You reap what you sow. If I wake up and I got it in for you and you and you, and I got it in for my wife and kids, guess what? Something's coming for me. If people want to comment about Benny Hinn or this, I don't have a comment. I respect all the spiritual leaders in this community. Methodist, Lutheran, I don't care. I respect the clergy. You don't need to get my opinion on the church or any of these other things. Amen. You don't need my opinion. You don't need an opinion. Who are we to say anything? Did you know that you don't have to give an opinion about anything? Because I know this conversation. Hey, Tom, you know what I think? Tom should say, could you stop right there? Can you really back this up spiritually or in the Word? Because I don't know if I want to hear about what you think. Because that's what the talk shows do. That's what our culture does. They put a panel of people up there. Let me tell you what I think. Let me tell you what I think. God doesn't care. Amen? He doesn't care about your opinions. Amen? He doesn't care about our opinions. Amen? Think about it. Resistance can come from a hardened heart. Why are you being resisted? Somebody's heart is hardened. Guess what? Your heart can become hardened. Pharaoh is an example of this in Exodus 4:24, Exodus 7:13, and verse 22. Then in Exodus chapter 8, verse 15, then we got verse 32, and then, of course, Exodus chapter 9, verses 7 and 35. Once again, Pharaoh's heart is hardened. Exodus 9, 35, let's read it together. And the heart of Pharaoh was hardened, neither would he let the children of Israel go, as the Lord had spoken by Moses. We know the Lord hardened his heart, but he still did it to himself, and he allowed that to happen. Why? Because God is going to show his glory. So you wonder why all these things are happening in the earth. It's because he's getting ready to reveal his glory. So he lets it happen. He lets it build up. It's like the cup of iniquity, amen? When the cup of iniquity fills up and it starts to spill over, bam, that's when judgment's coming. We don't know how high the cup is filled. Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. So when there's frustration in my heart, you can tell in my speech. You guys know me very, very well. Pastor Nick, he seems frustrated. Absolutely, frustration is in my heart, and I speak the frustration because out of the abundance of my heart is coming frustration. So what do I got to do? I got to get to the root of frustration so I can quit speaking it. These are simple things, everybody. Really, it's not that complicated. Little steps will change your life. Little steps will change your direction. Little steps will bring you divine providence. Restoration will always bring resistance. It's a contrast. Amen? It's a total contrast. I want to switch gears, and I feel led to share with you an example of Nehemiah. Amen? I'm going to point this out to you so you understand that this is relevant for today. Of course, this is Nehemiah chapter 1, verses 3 and 4. Let's read it. And they said unto me, the remnant that are left of the captivity there in the province are in great affliction and reproach. The wall of Jerusalem also is broken down, and the gates thereof are burned with fire. And it came to pass when I heard these words that I sat down and wept and mourned certain days and fasted and prayed before the God of heaven. So he hears about the people in the city of Jerusalem. He hears about it. It wasn't a good report. He was touched by that message. He was touched by that news flash. And he began to intercede. He began to care about something. Amen. And it came to pass when I heard these words that I sat down and I wept and mourned certain days and fasted and prayed before the God of heaven. See, I'm trying to position myself to care about what God cares about. You know what I really, really care about lately, of late? I believe Jewish people can have a home in Israel. I believe they can build a home and live there in Israel. Nothing against the Arabs, nothing to do with a two-state solution. All I'm saying is that if you're Jewish and you want to go back to Israel, I believe you have the right to a dwelling place. I care about that. Do I care about an Arab having a home? Sure, why not? We should all have a dwelling place. We're going to talk more about this on Sunday night. I'm going to open it up for discussion. We're going to talk about the two-state solution. We're going to talk about the facts. Okay? We're going to talk about a lot of this. Now, I'm drawn into the land. Why? Because I want to care about what God cares about. See, the problem with a lot of it is this, we don't care anymore. What do you care about? Pick your battles. What do you care about? You'll do something about. I care that there's toilet paper in every bathroom. I'm telling you. I'm using this as an example. I care that there's a roll of toilet paper in there and maybe even an extra roll if we have it. Scattered throughout the house. You know why? Because I care. How many times have some of you just said, I don't care, and walked away? I could have said that about the garbage cans. I texted Josiah, please make sure the garbage cans go out to the road. Why? Because I care. Amen. The Cabrera family, when you grab an envelope, thank the Cabrera family, and you know, little Christian puts the envelopes behind the chair. Why? Because he cares. He cares. You don't want to come to the place where you don't care. It's a very dangerous, slippery slope to say that. Because even if you have circumstances, even if you have pain in your ribcage, you should still care. Circumstances should not dictate how much you care. Nehemiah cared about the people in the city of Jerusalem. Once again, this is a picture of restoration, right? God is an indwelling, inbreaking God. He gets this message from a person, and he cares. What's the next step? He takes action. Look at restoration in Nehemiah 2:7. This is so simple. Read it. Moreover, I said unto the king, if it please the king, let letters be given me to the governors beyond the river, that they may convey me over till I come into Judah. That's why some of the Orthodox Jews made it very clear to me, the term Jew means they're from Judea. It doesn't mean that it came from Babylon or it means praise. I mean, the thing is, they're from Judea. He's making the steps. What did he get? He got a vision, didn't he? Did Nehemiah get a vision? Did he share it with the king? Did he get resources? And you're going to see where he's going to go back and get everybody to participate. And that's how you know if you have a true vision from God is, number one, you have to have resources. You can't just do a vision without money. You have to have finances. Look at the resistance here. Look at Nehemiah 2:10. Let's read it. When Sanballat the Horonite and Tobiah the servant the Ammonite heard of it, it grieved them exceedingly that there was come a man to seek the welfare of the children of Israel. Oh my gosh, how many people do we talk to when we say how much we care about the settlements and the West Bank and the Jews should have a home, that we care about, that they would look at you, I don't care, why should you care? You notice how I tied all this in? The enemy, the resistance was, a man came to seek the welfare of the children of Israel? I mean, look at this. I couldn't believe this. I was looking at this. This is what's happening today, everybody. I was thinking, oy vey, what is this? Listen to this commentary about the enemy of Nehemiah and the enemy of Israel. Think about this. Oh, it's playing out today. Sanballat was a Horonite, indicating he was either from Beth Horon in Ephraim or from Horonaim, the Elephantine papyri, referred to him as governor of Samaria. His opposition to Nehemiah was therefore politically motivated. The rebuilding of Jerusalem would eliminate Samaria as the political center of Judea. Tobiah, called an Ammonite, probably governed the area east of Judea. He was either a subordinate of Sanballat or in close cooperation with him. Amen? So get this picture. There's an opportunity in our government to take our embassy and put it in Jerusalem. There is an opportunity. Now, how many of you know that that doesn't fly very well among the Arabs? Why? Because they're jockeying for at least half of Jerusalem. So if you put the embassy of the United States of America in Jerusalem, that's going to infringe on what we're trying to do, which is bait and switch. Jerusalem isn't even mentioned in the Quran, yet it's the third holiest site. See, this is not about ethnic cleansing. This is not about being racist or prejudiced. This is a spiritual warfare. At the highest degree. So the contrast is, we care. Right? We care. UNESCO comes part of the United Nothing, right? That the Jews have no claim to this, this. Are you kidding me? The Bible's a deed. I mean, come on. The Bible's a deed. So what's going to happen to those around us when we say, we love the Orthodox Jews, we love the Jewish people, we love Israel, we love Jerusalem? What kind of recourse do you think we're going to have from other family and friends or strangers or whatever? I mean, they say that 72% of evangelicals are teaching replacement theology. How many of you know that that's not the kingdom of God? The church hasn't replaced anybody. Do you understand what I'm saying? Look at restoration in Nehemiah 2:17. He's a mover and a shaker. Let's read this. Then said I unto them, ye see the distress that we are in, how Jerusalem lieth waste, and the gates thereof are burned with fire. Come and let us build up the wall of Jerusalem, that we be no more a reproach. Amen. Do you see that? So everybody participated in building the wall. There's a long list of names of families and people that helped build the wall. Amen. Everybody did their part. So if you're coming to Beit Tehila and you're not serving, what part of the wall did you build? Amen? Tithes and offerings, that's great, but we need people with people. I need adults with children, amen? One third of our congregation is youth, at least one third, moving towards 40%. It's going to grow and grow. So if you don't like kids, get out now, because they're going to take over. Seriously, they're going to take over. Amen? Why? Because God said it would happen. When you see children, you see a future. If you see a church without children, that's a dead church. It's on life support. Let us build up the wall of Jerusalem. It was a good thing, amen? But look at the resistance. Nehemiah 2:19, let's read it. Look at this resistance. But when Sanballat the Horonite and Tobiah the servant, the Ammonite, and Geshem the Arabian heard it, they laughed us to scorn and despised us and said, what is this thing that you do? Will you rebel against the king? They don't know that Nehemiah has favor from the king. He had the ear of the king. Come on, somebody. Life's about who you know. You better start knowing some people. Life's about who you know. I keep to myself. You're not going anywhere. Life's about who you know. I find this interesting because how many of you know that word wall is very, very contentious? What we need to do is take the Trump supporters back in time through a time warp and let them surround Jerusalem, and they can shout, build that wall, build that wall, build that wall, and he'll have a hat on, make Israel great again. Woo-hoo! No, you guys laugh, but I'm telling you, Trump's getting, he's getting hit with everything he has, isn't he? He said, we're going to build that wall and they're going to pay for it. I mean, whether you agree or not, I mean, the man's talking about building the wall. I can just imagine what happened in Nehemiah. Thank you, Holy Spirit. You know what the enemy's going to do to us? They're going to come to us and say, how dare you love the Jewish people? How dare you rally for them and support them and love them? How dare you love the city of Jerusalem and want it to be the capital of Israel? How dare you love those Jewish people? How dare you? But that's what we're going to do. It's coming, folks. Oh, I'm not going to be like the Catholic Church during the Holocaust. I'm not going to be that. We're going to jump up on the soapbox. Oh, yeah. And we're going to rally. It's going to be life-changing. Look at Nehemiah 4:1 in Resistance. Let's read it. But it came to pass that when Sanballat heard that we builded the wall, he was wroth and took great indignation and mocked the Jews. See, while people are tearing down, we're going to build up. Amen? We're going to build this community, our next generation, and we're going to have associations with the church and with the synagogue. Come on, somebody. So while you're scorning me, I'm building the kingdom. Come on now, somebody. I'm going places. Where are you going? You can't even get out of the driveway. Come on, man. Give me a break. What are you doing for the kingdom? When did you build up somebody last? When did you hug somebody? When did you give something to somebody? Every week I meet my pastor friends and I spread out a spread for them because it's about hospitality. I spread it out before and there was some mix-up. Nobody even came. I didn't have any regrets. Why? Because I'm going to have hospitality. They're going to know Pastor Nick has hospitality. I put my table, I set it up for them, the granola bars, a little yogurt, some fruit. I added some pistachios. They love that. And I'm just saying that because it's in me. Why? Because I care. They deserve honor. I'm not asking you to do it every week. I'm not asking my wife to do it or somebody else to. I'm doing it. Why? Because I care about them. I show them honor. But it came to pass that when Sanballat heard that we builded the wall, he was wroth and took great indignation and mocked the Jews. Oh, if the embassy goes into Jerusalem, they say there's going to be some mad people. All hell's going to bust out. Well, so what? Let it bust out. It's already busting out. Revelation, read about it. The abyss is opened up and visitors come on the earth. And the Lord's just going to say, like, have at them. All the disobedient ones, have at them. Have at them. The abyss will be opened up. I love this. Now, that's Nehemiah 4:1, right? Look at this verse in Restoration, Nehemiah 4:6. Look at this. So built we the wall, and Sanballat's going to pay for it. Look, it says right there, so built we the wall. And all the wall was joined together unto the half thereof, for the people had a mind to work. Come on, somebody. It takes work to raise up the next generation. It's work. I've had some of you tell me, Pastor Nick, I've already raised my kids. I said, you ain't raised mine. Get to work. It says that the divorced mother will have more kids than the one that was married. That's us. It says you can't even count them. You see the restoration? This is so relevant. This is fresh off the press. Look, a plot against Nehemiah. There's a plot against you. Look at this plot against Nehemiah. Let's read it because it's actually, I believe, Nehemiah 6, 1 through 3. Let's read it. Here we go. Now it came to pass when Sanballat and Tobiah and Geshem the Arabian and the rest of our enemies heard that I had built the wall and that there was no breach left therein, though at that time I had not set up the doors upon the gates, that Sanballat and Geshem sent unto me, saying, come, let us meet together in some one of the villages in the plain of Ono. Oh no. Oh no, en contraire. Look at this. Come, let us meet together in some one of the villages in the plain of Ono. But look at what he says. But they thought to do me mischief. And I sent messengers unto them, saying, I am doing a great work so that I cannot come down. Why should the work cease while I leave it and come down to you? It's like when I went to Israel and I got off the plane and I'm a couple days in the land, the Lord's like just been really ministered to me. And he just showed me. He says, Don't spend time with those that don't spend time with you. Spend time with those, you know, that want to spend time with you. Minister to those sheep that I've given you. Don't go running after the sheep. Give your love and affection to the ones I've given you, not to the ones that are running away. Because a double-minded man is unstable in all of his ways. My wife and I have come to this place where we have to surround ourselves with people that love and respect us and that will join hands because the time is short. And he picked me, the stand-up comedian, to pull this off. I tell the Lord that all the time. But Lord, I'm a funny guy. I want people to laugh. He goes, well, you know, there's a time for that, but you're going to get serious. And that's going to be my life. And people might take me the wrong way. He's a little rough around the edges, blah, blah, blah. Just join me, would you? Would you just join me if you want? You know, if you're not for me, right, you're against me. Try to be for me. We got a big work to do here, everybody. I never realized how big it really is. We're not talking about just my marriage and my kids or this little church in the community. We're talking about an event. We're talking about the full restoration of the whole house of Israel, Jews and non-Jews, folks. This is groundbreaking. I'm like Martin Luther with a thesis. And I'm living it out, and I'm seeing it. I'm like, oy vey, Lord, you suckered me into this one, man. You got me, man. No, I don't want to do this. Come on. And that's what he did. He suckered me right into it. There's no getting out now. All those Jews have my email. Paul Picker won't let me go. I'll never forget. And this is what I'm sharing with you. You need to know. The Lord shared with me this quote, and I want to share it with you because it's relevant for this message. Never go to the critics, but let the critics come to you. Never spend time with the critics. Let the critics come to you. Did you notice Yeshua never went after the critics, but they followed after him? They followed after him. Somebody said years ago to me, he said, how can you leave a messianic congregation and you're not even Jewish? I went, well, you know, I'm trying my best. Why don't you just come and sit next to me and see how well I do? Some of you need confidence. Some of you have low self-esteem. You need to think more highly of yourself. Because what are the greatest commandments? To love God, love your neighbor as you love yourself. Amen? You might not even like the way you look. Amen? This is full gospel, everybody. Receding hairline. But I have to love myself because God doesn't make junk. My receding hairline is for his glory. And it's all vanity. Never go to the critics, but let them come to you. See, God has not called me to debate this message. He's called me to live it. I don't want to debate. I don't want to win in a debate. Look at this. Paul in Ephesus, 1 Corinthians 16:9. For a great door and effectual is opened unto me, and there are many adversaries. See, the revelation of God's knowledge and his spirit is creating a door of opportunity for all of us, amen, to express our faith in new and exciting ways and also to be with others and meet others that are on the journey. Amen. We're not a bunch of inbreds. That's what's happened to the Samaritans of today. They're a bunch of inbreds. They're dying off. Paul was in Ephesus, amen. He turned Ephesus upside down. Did you know that? He turned Ephesus upside down. And if I just go to Acts 19, I'm going to show you how relevant this is. When Satan enters people's hearts today, you're going to see the same action and examples in the past. Does everybody understand what I'm saying? Now, I'm going to show this to you in Acts 19. Talks about the riot at Ephesus. So now they're wanting to come after Paul because he's putting the idol makers out of business. Amen? Ephesus was a major, major port city. Major. And they worshiped Diana. Dionysus, amen? They worshiped Diana. And I'm going to look at verses in Acts 19, verse 31. So, and certain of the chief of Asia, which were his friends, sent unto him, desiring him that he would not adventure himself into the theater. Amen. It's not a good idea for Donald Trump to go and be in the protest. So there's a riot breaking out. And right after the inauguration, we have a march. And I believe there was one, what? The day after that or this week, right? Two different marches. Oh, and by the way, there is a contrast between those two marches. There is a contrast. I'm not going to go there, but I want to read something to you that was very interesting. And look at this. In verse 32 of Acts 19, some therefore cried one thing and some another, for the assembly was confused, and the more part knew not wherefore they were come together. People were interviewed in the first march. Hey, what are you doing here? I don't know. I just saw a bunch of people down here in the mall. What are you doing here? Well, women should have rights. That's what I believe. They should have rights. Of course they do. It's called the Constitution. But this is what the enemy does. Let me read it to you again. This happened to Paul. This is ludicrous. Some therefore cried one thing and some another, for the assembly was confused, and the more part knew not wherefore they were come together. But when they knew that he was a Jew, all with one voice, about the space of 2 hours, cried out, "Great is Diana of the Ephesians." For 2 hours they found out Paul was a Jew. Great is Diana. Great is Diana. I remember that actor. I told you he screamed at somebody. You will not divide us. You will not divide us. He went to jail. And you could just respond, "You're going to jail. You're going to jail." But this is what's happening in our culture, folks. Listen, this is relevant for today. You better avoid the mobs. Curiosity killed the cat. There's nothing down there for you to see, folks. Pick your battles. I got more things to do than go to a protest. You got freedom of speech. So you see this happening even today. People have lost their minds. They've lost their minds. I agree with freedom of speech. You want to go protest? I have no problem with that. But how are you behaving? What are you doing? What are you accomplishing? Isn't it crazy? Look at Ecclesiastes 3:15. Let's read this together. That which hath been is now, and that which is to be hath already been. And God requireth that which is past driven away. See, the Father is pulling you back. We're going to Father's house. We're making our way to Father's house. People are trying to pull you off the path to Father's house. So the question is, and not everyone's going to be here, not everyone's going to be called to Beit Tehila, but I would ask those people that have left, where is your path leading you? Give me an answer. Show me the fruit. Where are your steps taking you? If my steps are not taking me to my Father's house, I have misstepped. So no matter what I have to go through, I'm going to my Father's house. God requireth that which is past driven away. Nothing new under the sun. Remember that? People's behavior hasn't changed. So if Israel was a witness and a servant at one time, he will be again. And I make certain statements and I hold to them. I don't believe finding the name of Israel 2,540 times, that name of Israel, I don't believe we have the right to insert the word Jew every time. Let me say that again. for all of you watching live streaming, because now you're going to be held accountable. And you can quote me. I don't believe the whole house of Israel is made up of nothing but Jews. I don't believe it. I believe non-Jews make up that house too. It's just like one of the examples that I heard that was given. Just because you're from California doesn't mean you're not American. Ryan Cabrera loves that reference. He knows what I'm talking about. This goes back to 1902. Think about it. Think about it. Israel's made up of Jews and non-Jews. This is the revelation. But what's going to happen in the days ahead is, are you having a right action in your identity? So many deluding spirits, so many fallacies. Even among the church, oh, we're going to be raptured out of here. The escape mentality, and we're still here. It's 2007. And then 2017. Yeah. I don't know what year it is. We're in the year 57-77-39-3. Back in 2007, I added 10, and I got 2017. I'm going to edit all that. Don't worry about it. What I'm saying is that, look at this next picture. Obedience will always bring resistance, everybody. Now, why am I telling you that? Because I'm leading you to a place. I'm leading you to a better way, a better life. That's my job, to lead you in a better way and a better life. And if it doesn't work out for you, I will give you money back. Because I want a better life. I want a better way. I want to work smarter, not harder. So in closing, I want to show you this diagram. See, obedience will always bring resistance. Obedience will always bring resistance. Now, if you look at this graph, this is the revelation that I got while I was in Israel. I was trying to put everything together because it seems so chaotic and complicated, life. But it doesn't have to be. So basically what you're seeing here is, of course, Abraham's children. They're in three subgroups. Does everybody see that? Jews, Christians, and Muslims, would you all agree that Abraham had these three groups of people? Can we say that it was of God? Amen? Can we say that this is of God? Absolutely. And it's funny, too, because if you stop and look at Jews, Christians, and Muslims, one of the fighting is this. Well, the Jews believe that Isaac has it. The Christians believe Jesus has it. And the Muslims believe that what? Ishmael has it. So those three groups are jockeying for a position, even Christianity. Have you ever heard of the Crusades? I'm just saying. Everybody jockeying for a position. It was like Joab, the nephew of King David. He was just jockeying for a position. He didn't want to be king, but he wanted to be under the king. That's all he wanted. And he did a lot of bad stuff. And it was finally found out. He grabbed the horns of the altar, but he wasn't spared. So don't try to hold on to a position that you can't obtain. What are you saying, Pastor Nick? I can't try to be something that I'm not. I have to be something that God wants me to be. Does everybody understand that? See, a lot of people are still trying to find out who they are and what they are. When you get into a situation of peer pressure and a culture and all these other things, you're going to feel that pressure to want to be like them and accepted, because we all want to be accepted. If you'll stop and you'll look at this particular image, you'll look under the Jews. We have in the 70s, Jews for Jesus, the Messianic movement. How many understand what I'm saying? You guys lived through this. You know Woodstock and all that other stuff. Bob Dylan, you know, came out with a Christian album and all that, the Messianic movement. That's where the term really came about, was believing Jews wanted to practice their traditions and their customs. Does everybody understand that? They didn't want to do church like church. They wanted to do the Sabbath and the feast days. They wanted to have the Torah, speak Hebrew. Does everybody understand what I'm saying? And that makes sense, doesn't it? Can we say that that was a movement? Absolutely positive. Joel Chernoff, Paul Wilbur, they all came out of that. Believing Jews, right? So then what happens in the 80s? You get Hebrew roots. Now this thing just takes off. Now, doesn't it make sense that the way that God took the kingdom apart, he's putting it back together? Would it make sense? Right? To the Jew first, right? And now look, you're seeing the Hebrew roots movement in the 80s. What did the Muslims provide us with? Radical Islam. What movement has come out of Islam? That's all I'm asking. I'm not a racist. I'm not biased. I'm not prejudiced. I'm asking a question. ISIS, Al-Qaeda, okay? Shiite Sunni's always been around. I'm just saying that. Do you see where they're kind of stuck? And now the other two groups got to fight this group, because that's the identity they want to have. But why do they have that identity? Because it's a prophecy. His hand would be against everyone, everyone's hand against him. There's nothing new under the sun. God said it would happen. He's going to go on to say in the book of Exodus, for generation to generation, you will fight Amalek. So I understood this revelation when I went to Beersheba this last year, was sitting at the well and was going over the 10 promises or 10 things that make up the Abrahamic covenant. And one of them was many nations would come from Abraham. Also, he would become a great nation, Israel. But other groups of ethnic groups and subjects would come from him. Does everybody understand what I'm saying? This is why you have the people you have, the groups that you have. So we get all bent out of shape over Judaism or Christianity or Islam, and we look at this and we just get so bent out of shape, all the denominations and then even the different factions among the Jewish people. Are you conservative? Are you Reform? Are you Orthodox? Are you Lubavitch? Are you, you know, what are you? But if you'll notice, even in the Hebrew Roots movement, even among, you know, Jews for Jesus and even radical Islam, we have to ask ourselves a question. Where is this movement heading? Is the movement heading in the right direction? That's the question I want to ask. What are they going to produce at the end of this life? That's all I'm asking. I believe God can move in all of these groups. Jesus is showing up in visions and actually appearing before the Muslims. But what I want to submit to you is this, and I got to have a lot of chutzpah to say this, and it's not going to be easy for me, but I've studied the prophets and all these other people in the Bible, and I realize it's not going to be easy. We have broken off from all of them. It's not that we're special. It's not that we're just trying to isolate ourselves. But the Father wants to get something done. He can't do it in those groups. He can't do it. He can't do it. So this next year is critical. It's very critical that we hear from the Lord and that we are obedient, that we cast down vain imaginations. We put down our unmet expectations and we yield ourselves to God because it's his house. Unless he builds the house, we labor in vain. And I never want to take you down a wrong path. But I've chosen this path. Because right now, the Father is opening up doors to the church and the synagogue. It's unheard of. Right now, the hearts of Jewish people are being turned towards us, and we need to be there for them. We need to be Joseph's storehouse. I mean, not fair weather friends, real associations. Would you all agree? Do you understand what I'm saying? I'm not being critical of Jews, Christians, or Muslims in any stretch of the imagination, but I want to ask those groups, where are you heading? What's your mandate? A lot of it's lies. The things that they projected aren't even going to come to pass. So I'm saying, get your house in order. This ain't about doomsday. This ain't about date setting. Get your priorities straight. Get focused on what's going down right now. Come on, we all would agree. There's just so many verses in here we haven't even read or understood. We should want to understand. We should want to read this. And so what's happened to me is, and this is your homework assignment, go back and look up Ephraim and see what he's supposed to be doing and learn from what he shouldn't have done. I'll give you one little example here in closing. Jeremiah 31. I'll give you an example. Now that we know that we're the nation's coming back, now that we know that We are Ephraim, doubly fruitful. I'll give you just a little example. Look at this. Behold, I will bring them from the north country and gather them from the coast of the earth, and with them the blind and the lame, the woman with child and her that travaileth with child, together a great company shall return thither. Verse 9 of Jeremiah 31. They shall come with weeping and with supplications will I lead them. I will cause them to walk by the rivers of waters in a straight way, wherein they shall not stumble. For I am a father to Israel, and Ephraim is my firstborn. Who has the firstborn blessing? Ephraim. Where's Ephraim? He's all over the world. It's not under one man or one headship. If you see how brilliant and how smart God is? He's putting this together. Pockets of people all over the world, just like us. Hear his voice and obey. We don't have the bureaucracy and the church politics and all this other garbage. God has spared me that. He took me for his own. In the very beginning, he said, I will show you the way. I will guide you. You will not be caught up in this mess. You will not be victimized because you're mine. And I'm going to tell you exactly what to do and how to do it. And no man is going to corrupt what I want you to do. You're going to do it. And that's why I've gotten this far. And this is where we're at, everybody. And I'm telling you right now, it is the most exciting time I've ever lived in. Because I know good is coming. I know my rewards are going to be great. It says right here in verse 19 of chapter 31, Jeremiah, surely after that I was turned and I repented. Not judgmental, not criticizing others, repented. And after that I was instructed. I smote upon my thigh. I was ashamed, yet even confounded, because I did bear the reproach of my youth. Is Ephraim my dear son? Is he a pleasant child? For since I spake against him, I do earnestly remember him still. Therefore, my bowels are troubled for him. I will surely have mercy upon him, saith the Lord. Do you see that? If you tell me God's angry with you, that's not what he says here. He's given you mercy. He's forgiven you of your iniquities. What voice are you listening to? This is what you have to do. Prophecies are in here to prove that God is true. He's the only one that can give the prophecies. Do your own study, everybody. If I have defined Ephraim in an incorrect way, in a wrong way, fill me in, help me out. Because I've known this for 20 years. You define it for me. Do you think Ephraim are Jews? No. Doesn't make sense. But the enemy wants us to fight over the two houses, and it's just got problems, and it's replacement theology. All these things they accuse us of, it's a lie. It's just like Sanballat. Oh, really, you're going to do this? I'm telling the king. Hey, the king knows. So who are we to tell someone what they can and cannot be? When Jesus said, I have other sheep that are not of this fold, I must go to them as well. And what did Jesus say? This will mess up your theology. Are you ready for this? Hey, I only came for the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Boy, you better find your position then, right? Because he only came for them. Paul understood this. Think about the family tree. Paul was from the tribe of Benjamin. Who's the brother of Benjamin? Joseph. It makes sense. Doesn't it make sense? And then, oh, thank you, Holy Spirit. Oh, he is so awesome. So think about this. Here's the joke that God plays on the house of Israel. He lets Saul be a king. Saul doesn't have the scepter, folks. It's Judah. Did he work out? Because he's not supposed to have the scepter. Judah's got the scepter. I'm telling you, I know, maybe you're bored in your walk. I don't know. I am not bored at all. The lid is off. This thing is taken off. This thing is taken off. I'm just sitting back. You'll be approximately climbing 35,000 feet. Please put your tree in the upright position because we're going to boldly go where no Israelite has gone before. What do you want to show for your life? That you were obedient. What do you want to show for your life? I did what he told me to do. That's all I can ask of you. I can't deny the things that he's put in you, but I can't deny the things he's put in me. So when you come to me, you got a question, you need an answer, I'll answer the question as best I can, but this is a go. God is separating us so that he can have his bidding here. Isn't that what he did with John the Baptist? He took him out of the priesthood and said, you won't be preaching in Jerusalem in a nice comfy chair. I got that third rock on the left for you. And so what do? He brought us here to have this facility to do what we're doing, because he's going to restore and regather the whole house of Israel. That is the move of God right now. People ask me, what is God doing? He's writing Torah on minds and hearts, and he's going to restore and regather the whole house of Israel. So listen closely. If you can't do Beit Tehila, you can't do what's coming next. Some of you ask me, I don't know if I'm going in the right direction. I don't know if I'm supposed to be where I'm at. Well, listen, if you can't go back, you're right where you need to be. Well, I can't go back. Well, I'm like, well, then you're where you need to be. If you need to go back, go back. We're not going back. Listen, I've been doing this for over 20 years, people. I've been a pastor for 14. This is the real deal. I'm not some new kid on the block. I've been celebrating the Torah since 1999. I've been keeping Sabbath since 95. Okay? How many of the experience counts? Amen? I mean, think of experience counts. It's like a little series of teachings, isn't it? Let my people go, and then restoration will always bring resistance. These are just so encouraging messages, aren't they? I mean, I think Jesus would say to us, hey, I didn't say it would be easy, but it'll be worth it. So, Father, unless you build this house, we labor in vain. We just come before you. We bow before you, Father, and we just thank you for you are a great creator. We are the creation. Father, just forgive us of our sins. Your word says that you have forgiven us of our iniquity through your Son. And since we acknowledge him, we are free from that, Father, and we have forgiveness. Father, I thank you that you're not angry with us. You're happy with us, happy for us, and you're calling us home. And just like the prodigal son was in the house at one time, Father, we're coming to your house. I can hear the music. I can smell the food, and there's even dancing. But Father, we just pray for our big brother, Judah, who to some degree would be upset that the little brother's coming home, but he knows his father's house and he loves his father. And so we are coming home, but we pray that you would just turn the heart of big brother Judah towards us and accept us for the plan that you have put forth in the earth. Father, thank you that we don't have to have all the answers. We just have to be obedient. So I bless everyone here, Father. I pray that you speak to them. You give them dreams, revelation, knowledge, as well as me. You're no respecter of persons. And you give mercy to whom you want to give mercy to. And so, Father, we just can't thank you enough for giving us this opportunity to stretch our faith. Because faith without works is dead. And without faith, it's impossible to please you. So we believe, Father, in the restoration, the regathering of the whole house of Israel, made up of both Jews and non-Jews. I've spoken it forth. I've preached it. Whenever I declare the vision, the enemy declares his position. And so we thank you that once again, Father, unless you build this house, we labor in vain. We thank you for this. Father, we lift up Avi and his wife Rachel to you as they get traveling mercies. As Judah approaches Joseph, it continues, Father. He will be here on February 6th. Thank you for him, Father, and encourage him. Give him the desires of his heart, as well as his wife and the Lipkin family. Father, you are creating this reunion, and we love it. We accept it. Please soften our hearts not to be hardened. And I thank you for my earthly father, the great patriarch. Bless him, Father. Touch him right now. Show your love upon him. We just pray for the medical staff, nurses, and doctors, that he will have favor. In Yeshua's name we pray.